Good afternoon. Welcome to the 20th Annual Hesburgh Lectures in Ethics and Public Policy. My name is Scott Appleby. I'm the director of the Kroc Institute for International Peace Studies. I have been asked to ask you to move in toward the center of the aisles because more people will be coming. We'd like them to be able to have seats. Thanks for that act of solidarity with those yet to arrive. The Kroc Institute established the Hesburgh Lectures in 1995 in honor of the Reverend Theodore M. Hesburgh, CSC. Educated at Notre Dame and at the Gregorian University in Rome, Hesburgh was ordained a priest of the Congregation of Holy Cross in Sacred Heart Church here on campus in 1943, which means this is the 70th year that Father Ted has been a priest. This is, I think, the first year, one of the few years, that he has not attended this lecture. He attended last year. He'll be 97 years young this May, and he will meet our guest speaker, Ambassador Rasool, tomorrow, but he begs your forbearance that he didn't attend today. I think we can excuse him. He's been a priest for 70 years, as I said, at age 35 in June 1952. He was named the 15th president of this university and served in that capacity for 35 years until 1987. Father Ted built the modern Notre Dame, overseeing not only the rise to prominence of the university in the ranks of American higher education, but also the transfer of university governance from the founding religious community, the Congregation of Holy Cross, to a predominantly lay board of trustees in 1967. And he oversaw the admission of women into the undergraduate program in 1972. Father Ted has served, I guess I should update this, to five popes now. Three as permanent Vatican City representative to the International Atomic Energy Agency in Vienna from 1956 to 1970. At the request of Pope Paul VI, he built in 1972 an ecumenical institute at Tantur, Jerusalem, which Notre Dame continues to operate, as many of you know. Father Hesburgh has held 15 presidential appointments over the years to commissions on civil rights, peaceful uses of atomic energy, campus unrest, treatment of Vietnam offenders, third world development and immigration reforms, name only a few. At the same time, he remained an international leader in the field of education, an achievement that's reflected in his 150 honorary degrees, which is a Guinness Book of World Records achievement. The commitment to peace and justice and to exploring the ethical dimensions of public policy characterizes Father Ted's career. As a charter member and chairman of the U.S. Civil Rights Commission, as member of President Ford's Presidential Clemency Board, as a member of the Board of the Overseas Development Council, as chair of the Select Commission on Immigration and Refugee Policy, as leader of a coalition of scientists and world religious leaders condemning nuclear weapons. He's the recipient of the Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian honor, bestowed on him by President Lyndon Johnson in 1964, and of the Congressional Gold Medal, bestowed upon him by President Clinton and congressional leaders in July of 2000. Three related international institutes are part of Father Ted's legacy at Notre Dame: the Joan B. Kroc Institute for International Peace Studies, the Helen Kellogg Institute for International Studies, and the Center for Civil and Human Rights. The Catholic University should be a place, he has written, where all the great questions are asked, where an exciting conversation is continually in progress, where the mind constantly grows as the values and powers of intelligence and wisdom are cherished and exercised in full freedom. This spirit of open-ended inquiry that takes values seriously and cherishes wisdom has informed previous Hesburgh lectures given by Stanley Hoffman, Jean Bethke Elstein, Richard Falk, Michael Ignatieff, Martha Nussbaum, Saskia Sassen, Anthony Lake, Freeman Dyson, Michael Walzer, Ryan Hayer, Shireen Ibadi, Martha Minow, Francis Ding, Amartya Sen, and last year, Jessica Tuckman Matthews, president of the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. To this illustrious group, we now welcome Ebrahim Rasool, South Africa's ambassador to the United States. I am particularly grateful to Ambassador Rasool for honoring us with his presence at this busy time in the aftermath of the passing of Nelson Mandela. This year at Notre Dame, we are celebrating not only the life and work of the great man, but of all South Africans in their still unfolding quest for reconciliation and social justice. The Nelson Mandela retrospective has brought distinguished South Africans to campus, including liberation theologian and anti-apartheid activist Alan Busack and Chester Williams, who broke the color barrier in 1995 when he joined the previously all-white Springboks, South Africa's national rugby team. The Mandela retrospective is the brainchild of our colleague Catherine Bolton, professor of anthropology and peace studies and fellow of the Kellogg Institute, who has made all of this happen. I want to take a moment to thank you, Kat, for the good work on that. And of course, Ambassador Rasool, in arranging for your visit to campus, we did not hesitate to call on the good offices of our colleagues in high places, Rashid Omar and Ebrahim Musa. The high place they occupy is that of being your longtime friends and co-conspirators in South Africa. And so who is our honored guest and Hesburgh lecturer? The details of his biography are available on websites, which tend to filter out some of the really interesting stuff. There you will find the following. Before joining the embassy, Ambassador Rasool's most recent positions have included Member of Parliament in the National Assembly, Special Advisor to the State President of the Republic of South Africa, and Premier, Governor of the Western State Province. Rasool has a long history of involvement in the anti-apartheid struggle, starting at high school and including leadership in the United Democratic Front and the African National Congress. He has had to make sacrifices like spending time in prison and being under house arrest. Continuing the quote, his social and political involvement has consistently been faith-driven. He has been involved in both the Islamic movement as well as the interfaith movement and has been active in mobilizing Muslims and the broader faith communities for a deeper understanding of Islam and faith under conditions of oppression and currently under conditions of globalization. That's the end of the website material. Let's bring a bit more life to it by allowing me to recount a conversation I had with Alan Busack when he was on campus recently. I had asked Alan about the concentric circles of support for the anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa, given the complicated cast of characters in the mix, and he replied, "Many were with us in their hearts and minds, and we were grateful. But the core of the movement, those with the deepest credibility still today, gave their minds, their hearts, and their bodies to the cause of justice. I did so," Alan said, "from my Calvinist perspective, Ebrahim Rasool from his Islamic perspective, but we both laid our lives on the line." So we know that Ebrahim Rasool is a man of courage and commitment, but we also know that he is himself a rebuke to those who love to clump, cluster, and categorize people by skin color and perceived race. As Rasool himself recounted in 1996, quote, "If to be colored means to have mixed blood, then I have all the mix that is required. My maternal grandfather was a fourth-generation Englishman whose ancestor came to South Africa with the colonial troops at the beginning of the last century. My maternal grandmother's forebears arrived in Cape Town as Javanese slaves. My grandmother and my father's side was a Dutch woman, evoking speculation that Thijs Lerns, the former North Transvaal rugby captain, is my father's cousin. And my paternal grandfather was an Indian indentured laborer who arrived in Natal as a sugarcane cutter in the last century," close quote. So I imagine when you have to fill out forms that says check race, you do all of the above. As for the Islamic roots of his activism, Ambassador Rasool has also recalled his family heritage of learning to read in a variety of sources and texts. Quote from him, "So from the word go, I lived at the nexus of Muslim traditionalism and secular free thinking. I'm still working on integrating those two." To be fair to the formal bios and websites, we are indeed interested in the professional paths you have taken in fulfillment of your calling and in response to the special time and place you have found yourself in history. So, Ambassador Rasool has built up extensive experience of government, having led various departments such as health, welfare, finance, and economic development. And as Premier of the Western Cape, he was instrumental in attracting foreign investments into the province worth well over $1 billion American dollars, having the highest provincial economic growth rate, and making significant strides towards achieving millennial development goals. For his contributions to South Africa, Ambassador Rasool has been the recipient of a number of leadership awards. In 2008, he was awarded the Visionary Leadership and Public Good Award from the World Congress of Muslim Philanthropists and the Award for Commitment and Leadership in the Fight Against Crime from Business Against Crime. In 2005, the London Financial Times awarded him the Foreign Direct Investment Africa Personality of the Year Award. Mr. Rasool is also the recipient of the Nelson Mandela Award for Health and Human Rights, presented to him by the Kaiser Family Foundation in 1998. He is integral to the World for All Foundation, which rethinks the intellectual tools available to Muslims and faith communities that creates cooperative relations between faiths, cultures, and communities at a global level. Ambassador Rasool is a prolific speaker on a range of topics covering politics, governance, religion, Islamic and cultural themes across the world. He received a Bachelor of Arts and a higher diploma in education from the University of Cape Town. He is married with two children, and very significantly, his sister-in-law, Fatima Shahbodin, holds a master's degree in peace studies from the Kroc Institute, 1994. For so many reasons, then, I'm delighted that Ambassador Ebrahim Rasool has accepted our invitation to deliver the 2014 Hesburgh Lecture. Like his mentor and friend, the late Nelson Mandela, Ambassador Rasool was a courageous leader in the anti-apartheid struggle, who was in prison, placed under house arrest by the government. In addition to his diplomatic and political skills, he comes to us as an Islamic peace builder, experienced in mobilizing people of faith in the nonviolent struggle against oppression. Today, he presents the 20th annual Reverend Theodore M. Hesburgh CSC Lecture in Ethics and Public Policy, and his presentation is entitled Relic of the Past or Template for the Future, Nelson Mandela's Impact on Peacemaking and Statecraft in the 21st Century. Please join me in welcoming Ebrahim Rasool.
Thank you very much, Scott, for that really generous introduction. And when you do an introduction like that, when an old friend like Rashid Umar is with you, you get this nervousness because he knows your life so well. And it reminds me of this mother who took the son to the funeral service of the father who had just died. And they sang the hymns, said the prayers, read the scriptures, and they came to that part where they now pay a tribute to the life of the deceased. And someone from work came up and said what a wonderful worker he was. Someone from the church said how regular he was in church. Someone from his friend said what a great friend he was. And so they went on. And halfway through all of this, the mother took the child by the hand and said, "Come, my son, this isn't your father's funeral." So I was sitting there very nervously fearing that Rashid Umar would not recognize the person that was being introduced here. But I want to really thank Scott Appleby, the director of the Kroc Institute, for the invitation and the faith in me to deliver such a lecture of great responsibility and to do so with the example of Nelson Mandela as the theme. I want to thank Rashid Umar, who you know as a scholar of Islamic studies and peacemaking, but that I simply know as an imam who had changed a lot of my generation's perception of what Islam can be and how Muslims can live. And for that, I'm ever grateful that he is a leader, a comrade, and a friend. And for all of you who have made it possible for me to come here, despite last-minute glitches, thank you very much for wonderful arrangements. And I acknowledge the presence of the management of this university, the faculty, and the student body, and the staff. Thank you very much for taking time out to be here. If there is no university more fitting than Notre Dame, at which to honor Nelson Mandela, and no institute more appropriate than the Kroc Institute for International Peace Studies to reflect on Mandela's global lessons for peacemaking, then surely there is no person more deserving than Father Theodore Hesburgh, in whose name we come to celebrate the life, legacy, and values of arguably Africa's most revered son. And I don't even think that a priest from Uganda will argue with that. Father Ted and Madiba, as we have come to know him from his clan name, it's a wonderful thing to have a president where you don't have to say Mr. President all the time. You can simply call him Madiba. Father Ted and Madiba are contemporaries in almost every sense of the word except geographical. To honor Nelson Mandela in the name of a man who received the Medal of Freedom in pursuit of civil rights at the same time in 1964 that Nelson Mandela started his prison sentence. To honor Nelson Mandela in the name of a president who opened the doors of Notre Dame University to women at the same time that South Africans in the early 1970s began to regain their voice and to challenge apartheid again. To honor Mandela in the name of a global citizen who at that time already was advocating for peace, nuclear disarmament, and development in the world, while at that time Nelson Mandela in his cell on Robben Island was similarly stirring the conscience of the world against the inhumanity of apartheid. And to honor Nelson Mandela in the name of a president who retired as Notre Dame University president in 1987, at the exact moment when Nelson Mandela was reaching out and opening the doors of negotiation and finding a negotiated solution in South Africa, to honor Nelson Mandela in the name of Father Ted Hesburgh is indeed a humbling experience. So thank you very much to Notre Dame for this affirmation, to the Kroc Institute for seeing Nelson Mandela as a pioneer for peace, and to Father Ted Hesburgh for his faithfulness, his vision, and his service that has made the world a better place for all of us to live in. It is this acknowledgement that makes our loss as South Africans more bearable. South Africans, together with others in the world, opened the year 2014 without the reassuring presence of South Africa's greatest gift to the world, Nelson Mandela. Almost 50 heads of states deemed honoring Nelson Mandela's death more important than the myriad priorities that ordinarily would consume their attention. Billions of citizens across the world electronically bade farewell to a man who stirred their conscience from a tiny cell on Robben Island. Millions of South Africans were moved to anxiety about the future without the one who for six decades embodied first our yearning for freedom and then our quest for a dignified life. Hundreds of media channels across the world reached for the shorthand and sometimes the cliche to describe Nelson Mandela's achievement. The bloodless revolution, the miraculous transition, the lack of bitterness, the rainbow nation, Madiba magic, all of these were the imageries that were conjured up globally to pay tribute to him. And while each one of them tell a part of the truth, they may romanticize the hero and miss the point made by Bertolt Brecht in his play Galileo. In that play, Bertolt Brecht says, "Unhappy is the land that needs a hero. Unhappy is the land that needs a hero. Mandela's heroism is directly proportional to the degree of unhappiness in apartheid South Africa. This land had over 300 years experienced unhappiness at the hand of slavery in the Cape, a near genocide of its first people, brutal wars of colonial conquest, the relentless pursuit of gold and diamonds using expendable human labor, the systematic dispossession of black people of their land and their wealth, the blood-curdling massacres from Blood River to Sharpeville to Soweto, and an apartheid system that scientifically and theologically sought to legitimate itself through the assertion that blacks were indeed lesser beings in the hierarchy of creation. That unhappy land was indeed a land made for heroes and Nobel Peace Prize winners. But Madiba himself said, and I quote, "I was not the Messiah, but an ordinary man who became a leader because of extraordinary circumstances," unquote. Despite this, he captured the global imagination for his unyielding sacrifice, indomitable spirit, consistent dignity, and remarkable generosity. Most of all, the world saw in him leadership that was principled yet pragmatic, firm yet flexible, decisive yet popular. We live in a world today where all of these have become irreconcilable binaries, and as a result of that, we are caught up in a vortex of competing fundamentalisms, stultifying orthodoxies, and cynical postmodernisms. The eulogies for Nelson Mandela were often nostalgic for leaders who do not entirely navigate their leadership by opinion surveys, who speak from the heart and say what is right, and who are not always the slave of a script that is unfailingly prudent and on message. So much of the world, and so many in the world today, wish that they had a Nelson Mandela instead of the Pharaoh that comes back to banish their dreams, instead of the ideologues that lead them into a cul-de-sac of ideas, instead of the technocrats who offer managerialism rather than leadership, instead of the populist pandering to base emotions rather than engendering hopes. All of them bade farewell to a relic of the past, so that they have one less icon against which to be measured. The people who yearn for something better are the ones who see Nelson Mandela as a template for the future. They look at his words, spoken when facing a death sentence, when having no prospect of emerging from prison, when leading a risky negotiating process, when assuming the presidency of a fundamentally flawed country, when launching a constitution that directed a nation to its highest ideals, which they have not yet discovered, and inaugurating the Truth and Reconciliation Commission that would navigate an uncomfortable exchange. From his words, they extract the template for peacemaking and statecraft for this very troubled world in the 21st century. They discern from that leadership that can balance values and interests, people and markets, environment and growth, freedom and responsibility, and help humankind emerge from a stubborn recession and growing inequality, help humankind find alternatives to unaffordable and increasingly unpopular militaristic solutions, and to help humankind integrate the diversity of humanity who more and more find themselves sharing the same space, yet remaining strangers to each other. What makes Nelson Mandela a template for the future is precisely that his leadership is not glib, it is hard won. In his self-deprecating ways, he tells stories of learning to overcome prejudice, controlling his anger, disciplining his soul, and embracing the counter-instinctive. Certainly what he teaches us is that courage is learnt. Who will forget the words of a man facing the death penalty in 1964 and choosing to exemplify courage in pursuit of beliefs and ideals? We all know it by now, and he said in 1964, and I quote, "I have cherished the ideal of a democratic and free society in which all persons live together in harmony and with equal opportunities. It is an ideal I hope to live for and to achieve. But if needs be, it is an ideal for which I am prepared to die." He did not lack the passion and commitment or the willingness to die for his beliefs. But he understood courage in the Kantian sense of the word. Courage was the perfect middle between the passivity of the coward in the face of evil and the recklessness of the populist. The opposite of cowardice is not courage. The opposite of cowardice is recklessness. The perfect middle is courage. Courage was the ability to rise against evil in thoughtful ways. Nelson Mandela explained this to the judge at the Rivonia trial in 1964, and I quote again, "I do not deny that I planned sabotage. I did not plan it in a spirit of recklessness, nor because I had any love for violence. I planned it as a result of a calm and sober assessment of the political situation," unquote. Mandela's primary commitment was to live for his ideals, not primarily to die for them. His goal was to achieve his objectives and establish his ideal. But he would be prepared to die if, in his words, a calm and sober assessment of the political situation, unquote, demanded it. In the context of 1964, the calm and sober political assessment had led his generation of leaders to the need for greater militancy at a time when the African National Congress leadership was veering towards passivity in the face of a growing and systematic brutality from the apartheid state. But Nelson Mandela understood one other thing about courage. He also understood that it would be recklessness to ask people for sacrifices without them having a vision of the ideal. The ideal was to be the mobilizer. In the midst, therefore, of militant action was clarity of vision, presented through the Freedom Charter that outlined a life worth living. In inviting South Africans to this life worth living, people saw sense in fighting for it. When Nelson Mandela stood in the dock, prepared for the death sentence, people saw a leader was neither passive nor reckless, neither the reclusive leader escaping life's complexity, nor the martyr seeking a spectacular statement through his death, a leader prepared to die without making a fetish of death. In this approach, Nelson Mandela teaches us yet another lesson. Having ideals, having beliefs, and having a vision does not mean being dogmatic. In his own words, he said, "We operate in a world which is searching for a better life without the imprisonment of dogma." Without the imprisonment of dogma, unquote. The ideals to which Nelson Mandela were committed were ideals founded in a philosophical vision of a world of dignity that needed to be realized in a world of competing hemispheres and ideologies, the capitalist West and the socialist East, and on a continent of Africa that was one of the theaters of the Cold War, where newly independent countries from 1957 onwards were simply the laboratories for competing ideologies. Nelson Mandela and the African National Congress were excoriated as terrorists in the West and supported as freedom fighters in the East. They were drawn to the egalitarian ideals of the East and the democratic principles of the West. They were not free of the ideological forces and contests of the day. The ultimate success, however, of Nelson Mandela and his contemporaries was the refusal to be imprisoned by dogma. They understood their core values and were pragmatic in their implementation. They could be grateful for support from the socialist world and yet not be mortgaged to it. And they could be committed to democracy and not be discouraged that the hemisphere that taught the world democracy also gave the world slavery and colonialism and often supported dictatorships. In short, they could be committed, yet pragmatic. This was at the heart of the humanism that governed Nelson Mandela's thinking throughout his life. There was no exclusive adherence to a single tactic, and there was no elevation of one tactic over another. The history of struggle saw shifts in tactics in response to shifts in circumstance, from the early petitioning of the Queen to labor activism on the mines, from the Gandhi-inspired defiance campaigns of the 1950s to armed struggle after the Sharpeville massacre in the 1960s, and from campaigns to make apartheid ungovernable to a return to militant nonviolence in the 1980s, and the final assault on apartheid was the negotiating strategy. Nelson Mandela and the ANC lived by a simple dictum: firmness of principle and flexibility of tactics. This was complemented and needed to be complemented by a keen awareness of who and what the enemy was. The enemy was not a person, even though apartheid provided many hateful characters. The enemy was not a people, even though they were recognizable by their support for apartheid and the staffing of its institutions. The enemy was not even whites, even though they were identifiable by the color of their skin and were beneficiaries of black humiliation and dispossession. Nelson Mandela taught us, and I quote again, "I wanted South Africa to see that I loved even my enemies, while I hated the system that turned us against one another," unquote. These words by Nelson Mandela were the basis for a deep discipline that mostly prevented our focus from being distracted to personalities and people and away from a fundamentally evil system. It's because we recognized our enemy as a system that we could then embrace white people even as integral to the anti-apartheid struggle. There was no predisposition against the capacity of white people to be good and the possibility of black people to betray a vision of freedom. The struggle against apartheid was therefore both a struggle against an evil system as well as a struggle for the redemption of people. It was Mandela's ability to understand, in his own words, quote, "deep down in every human heart, there is mercy and generosity," unquote. In seeking to uncover these qualities in every human being, however, there was first the need to show the futility of the cause they were defending, the inevitability of victory for the forces of good. Secondly, there was the need to remove the fear that obscures the capacity for clear thinking and clear choice making. And thirdly, they needed to see that what they were forfeiting was more than compensated for by what they were gaining with the demise of apartheid. While such reasoning sounds strategic, sounds political, and sounds tactical, it is founded on a timeless African philosophy called Ubuntu. Mandela's definition of Ubuntu is simply, "we are people through other people." Archbishop Tutu, being a priest, uses a few more words, and he says that People are people through other people. And so, in this definition of Ubuntu, Nelson Mandela expresses his worldview that people are fundamentally interconnected, interrelated, and interdependent. The essence of Ubuntu is that we only realize our own humanity by ensuring the humanity of others, regardless of who the victim is and who the perpetrator is. This is the redemptive spirit at the heart of the South African struggle. To free blacks from dehumanization was to free whites to be human again. Hence, Nelson Mandela could say, all of us, descendants of Africa, know only too well that racism demeans the victims and dehumanizes its perpetrators. It was this perspective that therefore fundamentally meant that the methodology of struggle employed by the ANC had to reflect the objectives of struggle. A struggle for humanity could not dehumanize. A struggle for peace could not fundamentally be violent. A struggle for a better life could not destroy the means towards it. A struggle against racism could not mobilize race as its raison d'etre. Moral ends require moral means. That's the elusive wisdom in the world today. By people whose causes are just, may often be just, but whose means don't reflect the outcomes they want in the world. The anti-apartheid struggle was, therefore, not just to end racial discrimination, but was, again in the words of Nelson Mandela, a means for all of us to assert our common humanity. The enemy, in its human form as white people, could therefore not be demonized as non-human, as a racial category, as representatives of an entire religion, or as a permanent, unchangeable people who are genetically wired for evil from one generation to another. Black people were made to see white people who were doing good in South Africa. Afrikaners like Bram Fischer, trade unionists like Ray Alexander, leaders like Joe Slovo, priests like Trevor Huddleston, poets like Ankie Kroch, lawyers like George Bezos, and countless others. Black South Africans were systematically being immunized against becoming racists themselves. And in his address to the UN Special Committee Against Apartheid soon after his release, Nelson Mandela explained this as follows. All of us know how stubbornly racism can cling to the mind and how deeply it can infect the human soul. The struggle against apartheid was a struggle for the sanctity of the human soul and the purity of the human mind. It could therefore not be defiled by hatred and bitterness. The victims could not let the perpetrators be the authors of their destiny, just as Nelson Mandela did not allow his jailers to determine his disposition. He understood that if he emerged from prison with hatred and bitterness, he would still be a prisoner. Your enemy cannot define your response. Nelson Mandela showed this in his life. He was the founding commander of the ANC's guerrilla army, but he was never a warmonger because he respected life. He was the architect of our peaceful transition through negotiations, but he was never a pacifist because he understood that some values are worth fighting for. Thus were Nelson Mandela and the anti-apartheid movement able to capture the world's imagination through the unequivocal assertion of a desire for a peaceful, equal, and inclusive society. The moral cause with the broadest shared vision, underpinned by a set of minimum, eminently just strategic objectives, united people across the world and undermined the moral standing of the apartheid regime. An isolated regime tried many ways to ensure its own survival and to impugn its opponents like Nelson Mandela. They reached the stage where repression no longer worked because it crossed the threshold where it no longer induced fears. You saw so much death and suffering that you did not fear it any longer. Co-option failed because to be on apartheid side was to be isolated. Being useful to the West in the Cold War reached its end when the Berlin Wall fell in 1989. In 1985, Nelson Mandela's daughter Zinzi read a statement from him to a packed stadium in Soweto, rejecting the offer from the then apartheid president P.W. Botha for his release from prison. South Africa and the world looked on as Nelson Mandela rejected yet another conditional offer for his personal freedom. His reason was simple and consistent. In that letter he wrote, "Your freedom and mine cannot be separated." After 22 years in prison, he would surely be forgiven for accepting freedom. His wife was banned and banished, harassed and persecuted. His remaining children lived precariously, and his eldest son had died in a car accident. His mother had been buried without him. And ANC policy was clear that should the opportunity for negotiations be available, it would be considered. But Nelson Mandela understood that being offered his freedom for the purpose of negotiation, while personally convenient and politically justifiable, was not morally, politically, and legally sustainable. In that letter he wrote, "Only free men can negotiate. A prisoner cannot enter into contracts." This was the message Zinzi Mandela conveyed in 1985, noting that there was no free political activity while so many were imprisoned, in exile, the liberation movements were banned, and a state of emergency prevailed. Nelson Mandela closed that letter saying, "Until my people are free, I can never be free." His steadfast refusal to trade his freedom for that of his people had the effect of ensuring the imprisonment of the apartheid government. It was a political, strategic, and tactical imprisonment that the apartheid government found themselves in. It was the kind of imprisonment that sharpened debate and division among the white community. At the same time, the ANC invited a variety of leaders from the white citadel, business, academic, cultural, and religious, to meet the ANC, not its caricature that had systematically been built up, but the human beings that made up its ranks. Nelson Mandela, as always, had method to his madness. He explained it as follows: "Negotiated solutions emerge when those who have been divided reach out to find the common ground." Only by 1990 did the middle ground and the common ground beckon. The National Party had removed the belligerent P.W. Botha, whose harsh repression had intensified rather than subdued the resistance. F.W. de Klerk replaced him. Because he was conservative, he enjoyed sufficient trust amongst the Afrikaner hardliners, and because of his pragmatism, he was supported by the Afrikaner elite. On the side of the African National Congress, then ANC President Oliver Tambo had authored and won support for the strategy of negotiations contained in the Harare Declaration, firstly amongst African and world leaders, but also amongst the ranks of the ANC, where too there were those who believed that victory through armed insurrection was preferable and possible. In the negotiations, Nelson Mandela was the pivot between, on the one hand, a tentative and fearful white community, and on the other hand, a suspicious black community. In his relationship with F.W. de Klerk, Nelson Mandela understood that he could not sacrifice the fundamental objectives of struggle: majority rule through one person, one vote, and the progressive emancipation of all South Africans. This was also the guarantee he gave the ANC. But he always understood that when you have the responsibility to lead, you have to lead. And if we did not have that decisiveness at that moment, we could have been dawdling about the strategic moment that offered itself. Even as he was firm with both the ANC and with the white community, Mandela understood that de Klerk, as his interlocutor with the white community and its institutions, would be of no use to a political solution if he were emasculated. So many of the conflicts in the world today start off with the demand, this one must go, that one must go, only over his dead body. The counter-instinctive view that comes out of the South African struggle is you do not emasculate your interlocutor. And thus was born the dictum, strengthen your enemy. F.W. de Klerk was both the glue that held the ANC and the National Party together, as well as the glue that held the National Party and the white community in the negotiating process. Nelson Mandela understood that he needed to take responsibility to make de Klerk able to keep the white community going forward. And thus, the process rewrote the negotiations manual. It proceeded on the basis of sufficient consensus, meaning agreement between the two main parties. Significantly, it refused to allow anyone, especially those on the extremes, the right to veto the political process, either by their actions or by the reactions to them by the main parties. The most intractable conflict in the world today remains intractable because everyone knows that they have their finger on the veto button. You lob a rocket and the other side will withdraw. You announce settlements and the other side will withdraw. Today's peacemaking gives the veto away to all and sundry, whereas here, the refusal to hand over the veto was absolutely critical. And most importantly, South Africa became an example of how to negotiate a settlement without outside mediation that would come in. I remember the simple clarity with which Nelson Mandela addressed us as activists in the course of the negotiations. He said, when you negotiate, you must be prepared to compromise. Unquote. Only dishonest people or those who are not serious enter negotiations to emerge with the same positions they started off with. Negotiations are never between like-minded people, but between those whose differences created the conflict in the first place. But compromise does not always entail the sacrifice of principles. The objective is to know the overarching goals while being pragmatic on the path towards them. Thus was born the notion of sunset clauses. The sunset clauses created, for example, a 5-year window for an enforced coalition while delivering majority rule. It respected property rights while ensuring a reconstruction and development levy. It allowed job security for incumbent whites, but facilitated voluntary departures by guaranteeing pensions and voluntary severance packages. There was to be no violent disruption of the economy so as not to destroy what we needed to inherit, while ensuring targeted programs for economic empowerment, land reform, employment equity, and service delivery. Some have called the negotiating strategy of Nelson Mandela a process of incorporating the vanquished. He allayed their anxieties and embraced their symbols. He exuded goodwill through both concessions and the important gestures he made. But he also had to utilize enormous moral authority as the basis for his leadership within the black community, exhorting patience and more sacrifices while pointing to a vista where a better life would be born. But in navigating such uncharted even treacherous waters, as was the South African transition from apartheid to democracy, a deeply divided and unequal nation needed to be unified sufficiently to meet their future. Reconciliation was to be both a goal and a methodology towards its achievement. Explaining reconciliation, Nelson Mandela said, "Reconciliation and nation building would remain pious words if they were not premised on a concerted effort to remove the real roots of past conflict and injustice." Unquote. The rabbis teach that the intersection between peace and justice is compromise, believing that when the pursuit of peace is too absolute, it necessarily coexists with ongoing injustice. And when the pursuit of justice is too absolute, it necessarily often entails perpetual conflict, not peace. Society may often need sufficient peace and sufficient justice as a starting point towards a more sustainable future. The South African transition forced us to appreciate the gradations of justice, not its absoluteness, and not simply to inherit, not simply to accept the inherited definitions. The most familiar model of justice is what is called the justice of the victors at Nuremberg. This was absolute legal justice. This was a relentless justice up till today, where the perpetrator and the victim would not ever need to coexist in the same space again. For the victim would be found a new homeland. But in South Africa, we understood that we would continue to share both a space and a future, because Nelson Mandela understood that, in his words, we live in an interdependent world which is bound together by a common destiny. The emergent South African model of justice is closer to that of restorative justice that restores to all people, to all South Africans in this case, fundamentally their human dignity, substantially their human rights, and progressively their human needs. But in order to make progress towards this, we would first require transitional justice, justice that takes you from where you are to where you want to be, from the tragedy we inherited to the future we desire. The intersection in South Africa, therefore, between justice and peace would be reconciliation. And reconciliation was not the gift of a forgiving person or a forgiving nation. It was an exchange and was institutionalized in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission headed by Archbishop Desmond Tutu. It needed to achieve the twin objectives of truth and reconciliation, an exchange, if you like, of a full disclosure of truth for reconciliation. And reconciliation had three components: forgiveness, not from the state, nor from Nelson Mandela, but from the victims or their families. Secondly, amnesty, that on the basis of a full disclosure would absolve a perpetrator from legal punishment. And thirdly, reparations that would kickstart restorative justice. This was a healing period in South Africa. Blacks needed to understand that their pain had not been exaggerated, and whites needed to see what was done in their name. Some had the closure they needed, and others the amnesty they desired. But South Africans had a picture of the long, dark night of apartheid, and that's why Nelson Mandela's words at his inauguration echoed, "Never, never, and never again shall it be that this beautiful land will experience again the oppression of one by another and suffer the indignity of being the skunk of the world." But this had to be turned into a constitution. The new constitution, in the writing of the new constitution in South Africa, we inscribed the lessons of that long dark night. In this process, ANC members could draw on their experiences from across the world where they had been exiled. From the former communist world, they could retain the instinct towards egalitarianism but learned the hard lessons of the denial of freedom. From the capitalist West, they brought a variety of lessons on human rights, but were determined to avoid the soullessness of a system that rewarded the successful and often abandoned the rest. From the Scandinavians, they gained insight into a system where the state could be an instrument to ensure economic growth with social responsibility, and had the full experience of post-colonial African experiments to learn from. And so South Africa founded a constitution strong on personal and political rights, but balanced by socio-economic rights. And therefore, the state does have a responsibility towards the progressive realization of the basic needs of South Africans. We are indeed each other's keepers. But Nelson Mandela also understood, in one of those wise moments, the enduring values, the relationship between the enduring values of a nation and the instincts of the government of the day. He refers to the government of the day, even his own party, as a temporary majority. And he declared, "The key to the protection of any minority is to put core civil and political rights beyond the reach of temporary majorities by guaranteeing them as fundamental human rights." And he then proceeded to build firewalls between what a temporary majority may want to do to compromise those core values. The South African Constitution has as its cornerstone the right to equality and the right to dignity. And the right to dignity often, in the South African context, trumps freedom of expression, association, and speech. Because no speech, association, or expression should ever again indignify anyone through the propagation of racism, sexism, anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, xenophobia, homophobia, or any other prejudice or discrimination. Nor should anyone have the right to propagate violence and conflict or to incite hatred through the use of their right to free speech. Generally, South Africans decided to err on the side of inclusivity. All religions were deemed equal, irrespective of the number of adherents. Our constitution recognizes 11 official languages so that when we are most vulnerable, we'll be guaranteed communication. We have the flag with the most colors to depict the convergence of our political cultures. And we have an anthem that not only contains the two battle hymns of the past, but five of the main languages of our nation. South Africa also recognizes the cultural life of our people through, for example, recognizing customary, religious, and civil unions. And so, on the 26th of June 1990, when Nelson Mandela addressed the joint session of the Houses of Congress in the USA, he had just been released after 27 years in prison, but was keenly aware of his own mortality. On that day, he said to Congress, "It is a fact of the human condition that each shall, like a meteor, a mere brief passing moment in time and space, flit across the human stage and pass out of existence." Unquote. Nelson Mandela was right about his mortality, for indeed he has passed on, but he was wrong about his impact and significance in this world. He is not a flitting meteor, but a fixed star that guides our vision, anchors our beliefs, directs our efforts, defines who we are, and keeps us hopeful in uncertain and often confusing times. The world is troubled, and its people cry for something better. We are searching for a lost humanity and are yearning for an elusive solidarity. We miss his leadership. In celebrating his leadership, we lament often the abundance of eloquence and the paucity of integrity, the presence of words and the absence of communication, the exercise of judgment and the denial of justice. And Nelson Mandela understood these subtle distinctions because he wrestled with them every day of his life. He had the ability to know himself. He was imbued with a deep faith in his own cause, but carried with him enough doubt to see truth in others. He had sufficient confidence in what he stood for, but enough empathy to grasp the fear of the other. And while blessed with a wonderful self-esteem, he always understood that progress comes from working together. Such leadership needs courage. It is this leadership that the world desires, a world exhausted by conflict, bankrupted by war, shamed by intolerance. It looks yet again to Nelson Mandela to show the virtue of engagement over militarism, morality over legality, and the middle ground over the extremes. He cannot be a flitting meteor. He cannot be allowed simply to pass out of existence because he has unfinished business. He is not here, but we are. But in the times we live in, the enemy does not present themselves to us as they presented themselves to the generation of global leaders like Nelson Mandela, Mahatma Gandhi, and Martin Luther King. And so today, we must not so much fear the Caspers of Soweto or the dogs of Alabama, but must fear the fading of memory. We must fear forgetting where we come from, who we are, what we stand for, and where we must still go. We must not fear so much the whips of Mitchell's Plain or the batons of Selma, but we must fear the disconnectedness and the insularity, the individualism and the selfishness that tells us that poverty is because of laziness, disease because of immorality, and violence because of our genes. We must not fear so much today the lynchings of the South or the bullets of Sharpeville, but must fear the deadening of our consciousness and its attendant complacency that tells us that our struggle is over and the post-racial dawn has arrived because Nelson Mandela once strode the Union buildings and Barack Obama occupies the White House. The long walk to freedom is not over. In the words of Nelson Mandela, more hills are waiting to be climbed. He is not here to light the path with his courage, but we are here. We must continue the long walk until we have won a world that is more equal, where women are respected, where the stranger is not otherized, and where our young can dream again. Thank you very much.
Major talks don't always combine those three virtues, but you've done so elegantly. We have some time now for a conversation, for questions and comments. Two preliminary comments. I'm going to favor the students first. Not you, Martha, but other students. I'm going to favor students first. Any question, let students talk first. And Yuko is going to bring the microphone around for us so you can speak into the mic. And your comments succinct. So Marco has the floor first, and we'll go from there. Okay? By the way, please identify yourself briefly before you speak.
Your Excellency, you can hear me, yeah? Welcome to Notre Dame. My name is Marco, and I'm from Belgrade, Serbia. I used to be a State Secretary for Human Rights. I had a chance to learn within the government how it works and being in a country in transition. And last semester, I had a chance to spend 6 months in South Africa. I have seen the most beautiful places in your country. I've met wonderful people, but I'm still coping and trying to understand your transition. I had a chance to talk with Desmond Tutu in The Hague while I was at the International Criminal Court. And all those stories that we hear about South Africa are a bit different from what I've seen. I was constantly questioning how come your government even though very rich, is not able to provide security to people who live in Khayelitsha, in Manenberg, all those children who are suffering and being afraid of gang violence, not going to schools, and all those lesbians who are afraid of so-called corrective rape in South Africa, even though it's a rainbow country, even though your constitution is wonderful. I've seen so many black people who are poor, unprotected, LGBT community, and because you mentioned that there is a priest from Uganda, and because you said that there is a long walk ahead of us to fight, and Desmond Tutu said that homophobia is equal apartheid. Did you have a chance today to talk about apartheid or homophobia in Uganda where people are suffering only because they are different? Thank you.
Do you want to take a few? Or?
Yeah, why don't we take a few, please.
Thank you so much for your moving address on the former President Nelson Mandela. My name is Sarah Bosha, and I'm from Zimbabwe. I've heard people say that sometimes maybe the former President Nelson Mandela compromised too much when he made the agreement to enter into peace and transition. And I wonder what your comments would be on that, considering many years, almost decades down the line, we still do have black South Africans still living in shanty towns. We still have violent protests from them for basic service delivery. I would hasten to say maybe even the generations that yearned for that freedom and that better life that you were talking about, their children still are yearning for that and still haven't seen it. And I wonder what you think about that other side of the story, and maybe you have a response as to, I mean, how long till the progressive realization of these economic rights? Thank you.
Okay. Well, thanks very much. I think that dealing with the question that Marco raises, particularly the issues around homophobia and what happens with people who are different in the sense that they are members of the LGBTI community. And in dealing with it, I don't want to address anyone in particular. I want to speak to the issues that I think, as they presented themselves to us. In my comment, in the speech that I've made, I speak about how Nelson Mandela mandated a constitution that told us what our highest ideals would be without us even being ready for it. Because that's what constitutions ought to do. They are not your daily documents. They exhort you to what you can be, but you are not that yet. And so, had we taken, for example, a referendum on equality amongst different people, including, for example, religious communities, we would not have a constitution that makes all religions equal. We would not, for example, have a constitution that would, for example, make people of particular sexual orientations completely equal citizens protected by the law. We would not have property rights enshrined because the popular vote would go to take away property. And so a constitution fortifies you against your instincts and raises your eyes to what you can be. And therefore, that does not mean that when you have written it into a constitution that you have achieved the objectives that you have set, but you have set the goal. And so South Africa was able to lead the world in and to lead major democracies, including the United States, in civil unions, for example, in non-discrimination for all people, including members of the LGBTI. And so the test for us is whether our courts are able to deal with those who violate our constitution, such as corrective rape and all of those kind of things. And so just because we are on the move to something does not mean that we have perfected it. I think we are aware of what it is that we would need to be able to get right. I think in much the same way, because we have the dream of a peaceful future for ourselves doesn't mean that we are undamaged from where we come from. We have enormous pathologies that we live with. You could not for 300 years be told that you were inferior, non-human, just black, and then that reinforced with slavery, genocide, colonial war, massacres, and brutality, and then suddenly emerged as healed people even 20 years after Nelson Mandela became president. I think the wonderful thing about South Africa is that the conversation is remarkably frank. It's all out there. We're still talking about it. We don't live in a deluded state that we think we are post-racial. We live with our burdens and we debate it. And even when an Oscar Pistorius is on trial, we use it as opportunities to understand ourselves better. What makes a young person reach for a gun as his first response? And so I really want to put it to you like that. And pivoting to Sarah's question, you know, I held many executive positions in the Western Cape government, including that of governor, but was always completely aware of my limitations until I read a really important thing that Antonio Gramsci once wrote. He said that transitions are the most dangerous periods in the life of a nation because the old has not yet died and the new has not yet been born. This dangerous transitional period where the old and the new coexist, where our responsibility is to be the undertakers of the worst of the old and the midwives of the best of the new, is such a conflicting challenge to us. Your peace to get on with your life and the dignity that goes with it is often defied and challenged by the ongoing poverty that is a direct result of how you chose to make peace. And that's why I use the words very carefully. Fundamentally get our human dignity, substantially our human rights, and progressively our human needs. And we understand it like that. But the wonderful thing about South Africa is that our people, most of our people, don't walk around only with snapshots. They walk around with a movie. Because a snapshot captures a second in life. And you can see the shanty. You can see the unemployment on that snapshot. You can see the violence. But the movie tells you where we were, where we are, and what still waits for us, what the plot is that we are following. And the mantra that keeps us hopeful is one that says, today is better than yesterday, and tomorrow will be better than today. And so we celebrated the fact that we have now reached, 20 years later, universal primary school enrollment. And now we need to move on to make that a reality in secondary education. Because these transitions are difficult. If blacks were not allowed to learn math and science, and we make a transition from apartheid to democracy, but in a world that has made a transition from the industrial era to the knowledge-driven era, globalization, how can you have functionally literate and numerate people for a knowledge-driven economy? And if it takes you 16 years to get the first generation of math and science teachers, then it takes you another 16 years to get their first products. Now, those are not excuses. I think we've got to be able to do more. And it doesn't help when governments don't understand their mandates. It doesn't help when the few who have access try to reserve the access for themselves rather than remain committed to the transition towards that better life. And so we've got to be able to make those very important distinctions as we go forward. And so I would, and the wonderful thing is that people have not become dead, either through social media, where they can like on Facebook and explain themselves in 140 characters. They can go out there, burn a tire, protest outside the areas, because Nelson Mandela has inscribed the freedom that we need to remain conscious human beings. It is when people don't know that there's something wrong, where they don't feel that they can change something, that real death has set in. I feel hopeful, not remorseful, with every protest that keeps the spirit alive. And I am thankful that we have a government that understands that it cannot move against people's right to express themselves when they need to.
Thank you for the time, Your Excellency, and I hope you don't mind to answer my question, because it is more about your personal view rather than about what you've explained before about the Nelson Mandela. Okay, yeah. My name is Laili Fitri, and I am from Indonesia. So, I'm in my first year in MA in Krak Institute. So my question is, I've read several articles about you before, and also Professor Appleby has mentioned, slightly mentioned in the introduction, that actually you are trying to bridge the two worlds between the Islamic world, the traditional Islamic worlds, and the professional secular world. Now, as a person, as a Muslim, that I think I also should do this in my professional career in the future, I want to ask you, how would you incorporate these two worlds? Because from what I see and from what I read about you, you are somebody who has been successfully incorporate this world without resorting to the traditional Islamic point of view. You are not imposing the Islamic point of view to see in the secular, but you come with such a beautiful fusion of perspective between these two worlds. And the second question is, how can you, how would you locate the Islamic peace building in the contemporary South Africa in relation with the statecraft? Thank you very much.
Any other questions from students at this point?
Scott, I
hear. Oh, I'm sorry. This room is lit so I can see some of you.
Hello, my name is Tahir Close. I'm from Turkey and PhD student in political science here. First of all, thank you very much for your great and mind-opening talk. And I'm studying on transition, so my question will be in line with the previous question and your answer. And I don't know much about current South African politics, so it is more general, stemming from the South African example. So, you emphasized the importance of coexistence and cohabitation after the transition period, and that's why you talked about amnesties during the transitional justice process. And we see in many cases that negotiations between elites is very important in transitions, not just in South Africa, in many other examples, especially in Latin America. And I admit that it is almost an, it's an inherent process during the transition that you have to give some guarantees to old elites, to old institutions, because you want to bring to an end to the oppression or violence. But on the other hand, after years, we see that these guarantees and amnesties might create some problems. Now, today, after 30 years from transitions in Latin America, we discuss the deficiencies in democracy, especially in rule of law, because of the guarantees given to military and old elites during the transition process. So, on the one hand, in the short term, we have to give some amnesties and guarantees. But on the other hand, in the long term, it might be a problem. So how can we have a balance between these two?
We'll take one more question.
My name is Adil. I'm also a master's student from Lebanon in peace studies. And my question is going to be related to the role you played both at the grassroots level when you started in an interfaith community and also now being at the premier level and being in the policy world. And my question is going to be in transition and in regions of conflict. We studied that in order to build sustainable peace and strategic peace building, you really got to incorporate both the top level and the bottom level. You can't only work top down, you have to also work bottom up. And studying a little bit about South Africa and the lack of considered reparations, because we talk a lot about reconciliation, but we don't address reparations and how they were never achieved as they were recommended by the TRC. I want to see, how does your role differ between a person at the grassroots level who tend to be sometimes called as more perfectionist, and people at the policy level who end up doing the conciliation and the meetings and signing all the paperwork, but it doesn't trickle down, it doesn't really affect the people at the bottom. So I want to hear about your perspective at both levels and how do you succeed in both.
No, thanks. Thanks very much. Leila's question on bridging your personas, I think ideally, we're probably, if I were to answer the quote that Scott read out earlier that I said in 1996 to Charles Oliver Senser, where you got it from, about still trying to reconcile those two personas, I would almost say that it's to overcome the schizophrenia. I think that, you know, over 90% of the world's countries now have sizable minorities. And so where it was just a few before, and Muslims are now 25% of the Muslim community globally live under minority conditions. They don't live in majority contexts. And so the only way forward is to find, for all Muslims, a way in which to overcome a dichotomy. This constant in and out from your professional world and your Islamic world, because that, I think, is probably, from what I understand, one of the biggest recruiters for extremist causes. People who have not been able to integrate themselves within themselves can't integrate with their community, with their environment, with their new nations, with their new countries. And so the starting point has to be to overcome a paradigm of separation. That I think this perpetual Hamlet syndrome, to be or not to be. Am I American or am I Muslim? And I think that part of what we've answered in South Africa is that you can be both. In fact, you can be more than that. You can debate whether Muslim is the noun or the adjective, and South African is the adjective or the noun, and we are generous, we say make Muslim the noun because your faith may be very important, but you can be a South African Muslim. And in my case, I can be a South African Muslim of Malay origin and support the Redskins. So, although I don't know why anyone would do that, I'd rather support the basketball team of Notre Dame. But the fact of the matter is that we've got to be able to break down the things that divide us internally. And I think reading the scriptures with 21st century eyes and intellect, it's eminently possible. And so we've got to get away. And part of what we must understand is that so much of our law as Muslims have been written in times of dominance. They've never contemplated that we will ever be a minority. And so when you pray and how you pray and what you do and what you eat and all of those kind of things are written from a perspective of so much dominance that a lot of the tension within us comes because we are trying to take what we've inherited and apply it to contexts that defy the neatness of that. And so we think that our militancy may be able to help us along with this. And so I think that There are ways in which a new paradigms emerging that I think will help us, such as looking at the objectives of the law rather than the law itself, the letter of the law, looking at the values rather than the regulations of our faiths. I think that those are wonderful new mechanisms that I think are beginning to create a new way in which we can do things. And within it, we've just got to walk real fine lines. For example, you use the word tradition. I enjoy most of the traditions that come from my faith, but I am not a traditionalist. I don't worship tradition. It's just a wonderful way in which, and we've got to be able to teach people how to make distinction between traditions and liking them and the worship of traditions. And so I think we can get into some of those things. And that leads us, once we've comforted our minds and our beings and our souls that it's okay to be an American Muslim of whatever origin and to have great friends and to live through not maximum adherence but minimal compliance and find a space between that in living out who we are. Because sometimes we want to live by maximum compliance and then we veil and all of those kind of things, whereas minimal compliance may give us far more options to integrate. I think just making those changes creates the possibility of peace building, because we're at peace with ourselves now. We're not tormented all the time. And peace building should be easy in an Islamic context, because if the name of your religion derives from the word peace, if the first attribute of the God you worship is Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, if the mission of the Prophet is to be a mercy unto all, and the default position of the global Muslim community is to be in the middle. I mean, everything tells us that the ingredients are there, but it takes courage. And this is where I think that Kantian courage is, to understand courage as being the courage to not be a coward in the face of evil, but not to be reckless also in its face, but to find the perfect middle all the time. I think that coming to the issues of transitions and guarantees, you see, did Nelson Mandela see too much? I think we can argue that forever. Was it right to bring forward the kind of political and social transition and put on the back burner, for example, some of the economic ones? I think history will go on debating those kind of matters, but I think that we all do things within the capacity of our time. And Agathon teaches us that not even God can change the past. And so what has happened, and you've got to live with it. I think we've had enormous debates in South Africa, but I think that the guarantees that were given, for example, I think if you were to compare, how did the strategies of Nelson Mandela and the ANC manage, for example, an all-white army, an all-white police, and an all-white civil service, and ward off counter-revolution? And then you compare that, say, for example, with Egypt, and the inability to manage an army, a police, and a civil service that looks like you, eats like you, prays like you, and everything, dresses like you, but they weren't able to do it. You see, we don't think about, when you've inherited those all-white institutions, that it took an enormous amount of skill and wisdom to demobilize them to the point that South Africa has not had a serious challenge of counter-revolution, as we've seen in Egypt and other places. Not even a whiff of a coup. Not even an assertion by an army to be involved in civilian things. Now, we could have, when you sit with a dashboard of options and variables, we can all have our opinions about which variables to turn like that and which to turn like that and which to turn push first and which button to push later. But at the end of the day, our main priority would have been to gain the political kingdom, to ward off counter-revolution, and to create the basis for progressive ownership of the economy and delivery to our people. We've had a few quirks on the way, but by and large, I think we are on that path. And so, for example, when Marco asks about the LGBTs and South Africa, I would say that the US Constitution this year will be about 227 years old. And yet only last month, a governor had to override a duly proclaimed law in Arizona. This transition on that matter is going on for two centuries. I think we should be allowed a bit of latitude for two decades. And then, Adil, I think that the issue of reparations was a major discussion, and it's one thing after the Truth and Reconciliation Commission that many people have criticized Mandela and the ANC on, that they did not do what the Truth and Reconciliation Commission had said, that people who had come in front of it should be given certain compensations. And it wasn't that it was just ignored. It was that it was rejected, I think, in the ruling party, because it raised philosophical and fundamental questions. If this one had died, how much money do you give the parents as compensation? And if I spent 10 years in prison, how much should I be compensated for that? And when you begin to put a monetary value on people's sacrifices, you get into very murky waters, I think. And that is really the kind of debate we've had. It's not an unconscious thing. It is. What we thought we'd do was to actually reach our goals in building 3 million houses. And so 4 million have been built over this 20 years, in getting everyone connected to a tap within their property, rather than designate a young child to be the fetcher of water every day, to get everyone into a radius of 10,000 people per health facility, and that the reparations should be social in the first instance, rather than simply put a financial value on a life, on a sacrifice, on a jail term, and so forth. So I think that those are really some of the issues that we needed to get going. I think that that we are very fortunate that we have delayed to a large extent the creation of an outright elite in South Africa at political decision-making level. I think as we go to our second 20 years, it's something we've got to continue watching and to make sure that our communities remain really vibrant in the way in which the grassroots asserts itself in the body politic of South Africa.
I'll open up for just one more brief round, if that's with your permission, and we'll go beyond the student group now. Go ahead.
I'm Len Korczynski from Mishawaka. I don't have a question, but I just have a comment. And I thank you very much for talking about Nelson Mandela, and I think that all will apply to my comment, because we are in an apartheid situation in the United States. We have on one side those that are living. We have on the other side 6,000 innocent people are killed every day legally. Wow. Is that an apartheid? I would think so. So all that you mentioned with regard to Nelson Mandela would apply even to this situation of apartheid in the United States.
Thanks for your comment. There are other hands. Let me just see. I'll come back over here, okay? Of course, I can't see. Is that a message?
I'd like to suggest that Pete Walsh, Koch Institute of Political Science here at Notre Dame, I'd like to suggest that
I'd like to suggest that the achievements of Nelson Mandela and the transition in South Africa came in a very awkward situation internationally, where the free market was beginning to contest the right even of representative government to constrain it, and that therefore South Africa faces a problem that almost every other country in this world is now going to have to face. Can we sustain our democratic institutions in the face of the gap between rich and poor, the dominance of our political system by the rich, and in effect the undermining of several centuries of struggle for the search for the common good? What you've outlined as a vision is very moving, perhaps the most moving presentation I've heard in my fairly long lifetime. But we face an enormous problem of how the free market could crush that and yet claim moral ascendancy and even a vision of the utopia. It's a very nasty situation.
Right behind you there, I'm glad to see we have more students with questions, and we'll go to them, please.
Ambassador, thank you so much for your time. My name is Prashant Divis. I'm a master's student from Sri Lanka. The question is a lot to do with Sri Lanka and South Africa relations right now. Just after our civil war, the Sri Lankan government is now in conversation with South Africa on trying to use the truth and reconciliation model in Sri Lanka. However, many of us have the concern that it is an opportunity for perpetrators to walk out scot-free for what they have done, or just get a slap on the wrist for pretty strong evidence of human rights violations that took place during the final stages of the war. At the same time, how would you respond if the great legacy of President Mandela and the Truth and Reconciliation Committee in South Africa is used in a manner for corrupt regimes to hide their sins? And that would be a dishonor, at least in the way I see it. Along with that, also the fear of trying to use a model that was used where an oppressed majority started leading a country as opposed to an oppressed minority. And now being continue to be oppressed by the government that is responsible for some of the accusations made. So we'd like to hear your thoughts on that. Thank you.
We've got two more over here, and then we'll let you answer all of them, and we'll adjourn at that point. Please make your questions succinct, however.
Okay, thank you. My name is Elizabeth, and I'm from Bulgaria. I'm also a student at the Kroc Institute. And my question is, in your speech, you mentioned that the enemy back in the past was the apartheid regime, the system. So I'm just curious about what your analysis of who the enemy today is in terms of the structural conditions and what South Africans should do to oppose it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Ahmed Ali. I'm Egyptian, a scholar here. So my question is, what went wrong with the Arab Spring? And and how to restore peace again in Egypt? Okay. Thank you very much.
I give you full permission to wait for another lecture
to answer. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much. I think that I'll take the first one as a comment, but I think that it really defies the mind that a great nation can't muster a lot of resources for fairly self-evident things that the world looks at and wonders, how does this work? I made a joke the other day by saying that the way in which I see some people, particularly on the far right, reading the US Constitution is no different to how I see some fundamentalist Muslims reading the Quran. The literalism is there, the decontextualization is there, etc., etc. And I think that that really is, on a lighter note, however, I said to the First Lady of the US, the only one who should have the right to bear arms is she. But I think that as should be expected from Professor Walsh. It's really one of the most incisive bits of analysis. Because, you know, how can you be fighting for almost 8 decades to ensure a transition from apartheid to democracy? And then, and for national sovereignty. And then when you achieve it, you wake up to learn that the world had undergone a transition from a bipolar world to a unipolar world, from an international system to a global system, from a system of the sovereignty of the nation state to a borderless system. And that's effectively the reality that we live in. Who will forget the first day Nelson Mandela walks out of prison, goes to the city hall in Cape Town and speaks about nationalizing the mines, nationalizing the farms, nationalizing the means of production and all of those kind of things. And we only later get a chance to describe the world to him. And Nelson Mandela then understands, and that's the greatness, the adaptability of the man. He then understands that what he went into jail with as a vision was no longer possible because of a fundamental change in the world. And so not only are you warding off counter-revolution from the white institutions that I spoke about, but you're also dealing with salvaging as much national sovereignty as possible to make your own decisions. And for many years, we refused to borrow money. People were saying, why don't you become like Zimbabwe? They were borrowing a lot, that free education, free health, free this, free that, and they've had some wonderful human resource development that we could only envy. But I think we try to make a choice not to distribute what we did not grow. Because when you do that, when the world calls in its markers, you implode very fast, like we've seen in Zimbabwe. So tightening our belts and really trying to not get a DIY structural adjustment program going, I think all of those kind of things was absolutely critical to us. And sometimes we made mistakes in our zeal to protect ourselves, in the fight we made with pharmaceuticals, to rather wait out until a particular antiretroviral's patent lapsed, and to ask people to just hang on for 2 more years, this will lapse and then the Indians will have it at a fraction of the price, rather than sign up long-term deals at 40% discount. I mean, those were hard decisions, often appearing callous. But those were the things we did to try and salvage as much of our national pride and sovereignty as we could. And I think people must be able to understand. And so to Egypt, for example, I spent about 4 days in Cairo as a guest of then Mohamed Morsi, and really sat with some of these things that we were speaking about. And I don't think they understood always who the army was and the desperation there. I don't think they understood their importance in the geopolitical world. I mangled some metaphors in trying to explain this because I said that Western powers have deliberately given the middle part of the world a triple bypass of democracy, human rights, and freedom. Because this part of the world is viewed not through the values of the West, but the interests of the West. And therefore, if South Africa had to be careful about counter-revolution, Egypt had to be 10 times, 100 times more careful because of that. In trying to understand what the reaction of the world was to the Arab Spring. And again, this is where the second mangling of metaphors come. It was a three-horse situation where the horses who were historically running against the West, regime change was on the agenda. The horses that had bolted, or the horses that were in their stable, were by and large given a free pass. Like Bahrain, who housed the fifth fleet of the US, Saudi Arabia, and Yemen, who had the intelligence center in the war against terror. They were allowed the space to reform themselves and to make some changes quickly. The horses that had bolted, that caught the world by surprise, they couldn't be seen to be pulling them back like they would have done in 1953 in Iran. But to allow an implosion to begin to take place. And fortunately, Tunisia has headed off that implosion by, in a sense, paying a price by saying, you have the government. And so these are magnified in the 21st century, but they were no different to what we faced. We were fortunate that, unlike in Egypt, where the Brotherhood was effectively underground, we had an underground and we had an exile. And our exiles weren't all in Moscow. They were in London, they were in Washington, they were all over reading the trends in the world. Thabo Mbeki studied at his master's in economics at LSE and so forth. So I think that was what was different, to be able to manage this dashboard of variables in front of us. I think that I'm trying to take my time to get to Sri Lanka. But on the issue, just on Sri Lanka, how's our relationship today? I think we didn't like the fact that you beat us in the T20 Cricket World Cup. But I think that some of the people that Rashid and I had worked with, the former president of WCRP, the World Conference on Religion and Peace, and a commissioner in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, Yasmin Suka, had been fairly instrumental in the investigations that have gone on there. But you know, the Nelson Mandela package is precisely that. It's a package. It's not a supermarket where you choose your aisle and you choose your product and you choose your brand. You've got to be able fundamentally to take the whole package. You can't have reconciliation if you don't have truth. You can't get amnesty if you don't confess and show the bodies. Because that's what we did. We took some of the people to where they confessed to having made the graves and buried they had to produce the victims. You couldn't have a generalized mea culpa. You couldn't have a delegated mea culpa, let the head of the party or the general in the army say, you had to come for yourself. So you see, some people take the amnesty concept, but not the methodology. And so I think that we've got to treat Nelson Mandela as a package, and that, I think, is the one way to avoid the misuse and the subversion of his being a template for the future. And so we've got to protect this legacy, because it worked in South Africa. We've even helped it to get working in Ireland and in the Great Lakes of Africa, in the Sudans and everything like that. But that's because we treated it like an integrated whole rather than dismembered set of tactics that people could be using. And then, how does the enemy present itself today? Elizabeth asks. I think that the fundamental thing that is absent in helping us navigate this complex world today is that I don't even think we have a vision. I don't even think that we believe that life can be different and better. And the point that I made was that Nelson Mandela understood that when he calls people to struggle, you've got to present a vision. And that's where the Freedom Charter was, this beacon that cohered our thinking and our ideas and made us move around it. And then we didn't complicate our vision by adding too many details. We had a simple mantra, a united, non-racial, democratic, non-sexist South Africa. We didn't confuse the world with the intricacies of our internal debates. Whoever we were, we stood in the world, said those five things, and the world was mobilized behind us. It's an art that, for example, the Palestinians don't have, because they export their divisions, their nuances, and so forth. And so you have Hamas supporters and Fatah supporters rather than Palestinian forces. And I think the Egyptians may be in danger of doing much the same kind of thing. And the Syrians, definitely, I think, are suffering because of that absence of a broad, minimal, unifying vision that you put out to the world. But globally, what is this vision? I think we're living in a situation where the left hasn't recovered from the Berlin Wall's fall, and where the left is caricatured by the antics of Vladimir Putin and others, where you've got, in advanced democracies, to be relevant, the left has to go to the right side of the spectrum. So who's presenting the alternative? What is this alternative? It's variations on the right theme or the right word theme. And so I think that we need to understand what can this world be. I don't think we're dreaming enough. And because we're not dreaming enough, we're not giving a vision to the next generations. And I look at my children, I fear that they will live up in a world without a cause, because everything insulates them. They think they have friends, but it's all electronic. My daughter has a friend in crisis. I had to phone her today to say, stop texting. Dial the number and speak. Because we become Facebook revolutionaries. And as they discovered in Egypt, you can express outrage and you can even create but you can't win elections. You can't win your vision. You're disconnected. So I think we need to be able to understand how we are able to really move forward. And I think that it's that absence of vision also that I think has hampered a lot of the Arab Spring. Because at the moment of victory, really revolutionaries that we've admired, who were secularists, made the Brotherhood out to be a greater enemy than the army. And they may have good reason. But the fact of the matter is, you've got to almost understand the world as, who are the forces for good or potential good in the world? And who are the forces of reaction? And I think that those are just some broad thoughts without answering the question in any great way.
Time to jump into a car at O'Hare and have a handful of trail mix and a couple of glasses of water, and yet this was one of the most generous performances and presentations we've had. So thank you again for your insight.